Georgetown meeting for the third time. They have split the two previous meetings. In 1952, Don Donner was a sophomore guard on the Dayton ball club, and they won it. And then in 1978, Georgetown won in the second round of NIT play. And Don Donner has been a miracle man. Dayton, impressive win. They started out with a win over LSU. Then they added Oklahoma to their list and then defeated Washington here Friday night. The size differential, we posted that at the start, and it's very evident here at the center jump, as you're going to have Chapman at 6'4", going against Ewing at 7'.
But Chapman's a quick leaper, and there, Ewing wasn't ready. Patrick Ewing was looking down, wasn't ready to jump at all.
That's some kind of a trend we may see today.
John Thompson talking to the official. How about warning our players? There's Georgetown in that starting 2-1-2 zone.
Edward Coney, number 3, the junior from Dayton. Ed Young has not been scoring as much in the tournament as he did in regular season. Coney missing. Schellenberg is there, and he gets it in.
Schellenberg is 6'3", but probably closer to 6'2", 6'1.5", goes right up over Ewing.
Schellenberg has kind of been the leader in this tournament. He's taken over the leadership role of the Flyers.
And there's Chapman matched up against Dalton. 6'3" against 7', or 6'11".
Wingate misses. Here comes Tony. This is headed for Chapman. He has a handle eventually, and he has another 2 points.
Well, it's obvious, Gary, that Dayton's going to take advantage of the break if it's there. It's not going to be a total slowdown game, which is very good strategy.
They came out and obviously not in awe of this Georgetown team at all.
Great man-to-man. And you can see when it goes into Patrick Ewing, everybody collapses.
Michael Jackson, the sophomore, excellent shooter, followed by Wingate. There, whether it was Wingate, Jackson again, and Georgetown is on the scoreboard.
And Georgetown very overpowering on the board, and here they go into their full court pressure.
They're the number 2 rebounding team in the country, Georgetown. They've out-rebounded teams by an average of 10 a game.
You see, Georgetown uses Dalton as the point. It's hard to throw the ball over him, obviously.
Foul will go on Fred Brown. Dayton must shoot the ball well. That's been their forte all year long. But they have been surprising in the rebounding. They picked it up in tournament play, screening and blocking off well.
And Gary, now Georgetown going to their 1-3-1 trap. They have Dalton in the middle. They're showing a lot of different defenses right out of the box.
You've got 6'11 Dalton and Ewing. There's not a lot of room in there.
Ewing really comes out from underneath that basket to protect the guys that want to take a jumper from the wing.
This is Goodwin. Goodwin has been shooting so well from the free throw line.
Ewing looking for the lob. He gets down the court so well on the break.
Georgetown with a chance to tie it up. Pat Ewing rebound. Schellenberg had position, and they call a foul on him.
Thought that was Brown coming over his back. Don Donner not liking the call a bit.
Schellenberg, the junior, out of Indiana. He's come through in all phases of the game. Don Donaher does not voice his displeasure that much. He's very calm and collected on the sideline, but not happy with that one. Jackson has tied it up.
One of the things that really helps Georgetown, they have a power game inside, but John Thompson really has good perimeter shooting in Jackson and Broadnax when he comes off the bench.
Well, we haven't seen anybody pressure Dayton effectively. They handle all the pressure throughout the tournament.
Well, you're looking at a team basically with 4 guards. They've got 4 guards and a forward in their starting lineup.
Young and difficulty steps on the baseline, and that'll turn it over to Georgetown.
They all catch the ball well, they handle the ball well, and they don't force a lot of things. So you get a well-coached club with 4 basic guards on the floor to stuff the pressure.
There's Fred Brown, who does what John Thompson wants. He's like another coach on the floor in the estimation of John. Here's Ewing again, and he's on the scoreboard.
Gary, it's always difficult to defend a team that's got a good perimeter shooter that feeds the post well, because if you collapse, he can make the jump shot. If you stay out, it leaves Ewing wide open.
Ewing really missed Fred Brown. He missed Brown last year when he was out most of the year with a knee injury.
No question. And there's Ewing back there running the baseline. Brown, aggressive defender.
And Goodwin picks it back out to Schellenberg. Back to Goodwin. Good ball movement.
That was a great screen by Young. He caught Ewing on the inside, and he set a screen on him so that Ewing couldn't get back out to Goodwin.
And it's all even at 6. Georgetown coming in here with a record of 31 wins and only 3 losses. Jackson There's Ewing inside. Good foul. And that is going to be a foul. It's going to go against Dayton. And Ewing.
Wait a minute.
Is it going to be on Ewing?
Here's where Patrick Ewing is amazing with his power. He had the ball in his possession. He's going to be so strong here that when he grabs the ball, he's going to hit Schellenberg. Now watch it. He's going to get it on this rebound. He has the ball in his possession, and there's Schellenberg. He just drives him out of the way. Foul on Ewing.
A lot of bulk in there, and the guy who's a real warrior, Ewing, has picked up his first foul.
Ed pressing, jabbing, showing good patience.
The call, 16-13 to go in this first half.
The reason that press is so effective is you have Ewing all the way back there as a safety man, so even if you lob it over the press, it's hard to go to the basket with the ball.
Ewing just slapped
look
it out
at
of
this
there. Schellenberg recovered it, but he threw it away.
Now, wait a minute. That ball is not out of bounds. Because the first thing that it touched was the Georgetown player on the sideline.
Michael Graham. Graham is coming in. Let's see if we can pick it up on a replay.
Let's see this a second. Now, Ewing really does his job showing how he can come out and defend. I want to see who's the first person this touches. That ball is not out of bounds until it touches a man on the sideline.
Well, the officials did award it to Georgetown. Again, it's batted out of bounds. The Hoyas will still maintain possession.
Garrett Graham was not in the game, so he wasn't officially a player. But he's down on the sidelines. He should not have touched that ball. It was the proper call, but he should have just let it go out of bounds and hit something else.
There's Graham, a block by Chapman. Chapman up above him. The Graham 6'9", so he got up above the 6'9 Graham.
Some timing. The thing I like about Chapman, he lets the game really come to him. Even though he's a great scorer, he doesn't pressure himself into getting off a lot of shots.
8-3 of 6 from the field. On the other hand, Georgetown's in only 3 of their 10 offerings thus far.
And Graham much more active than Dalton in the center.
Tony, he came out shooting the ball with confidence. He has given Dayton a 2-point lead.
Tony's been a hot shooter throughout the tournament. He's had some great streaks throughout this year.
He had 14 points against Washington and hit 6 of 8 from the field in that game. Brown is not an outside shooter.
And a man back in inside the foul line. We saw Indiana play yesterday. Very similar to that defense.
There's that rebounding that's been so surprising. Chapman is there. Now to be careful.
Beautiful pass to Young.
All 5 starters now for Dayton have scored, and that might answer the question whether Chapman could play a guard in the pros. He handled it well.
Good point, Gary. A lot of people have been asking that since he's been the top player in the NCAA individually so far in the tournament. A lot of pro people saying, can this guy play guard? He showed a little bit there.
Red Brown on the reverse move. That was Ewing with a good vision of the court that time, getting the ball to the baseline. We have a timeout. 14 came to go in this first half. Dayton leading Georgetown by 2. 14-10 to go in the first half, and Dayton has come out here and played very effectively with a 2-point lead, 10-8. Dayton shooting 63% from the field. Georgetown only 33, and Dayton has all 5 of their starters in the scoring column. I think it shows again, Dayton playing with, as that old proverb goes, with nothing to lose and everything to gain. They come out loose, not intimidated, not in awe at all of the second-ranked team in the country, the top seed in the West.
Gary, when you have a club that's very well coached and they get the confidence that they've had throughout this year as well as playing in the NCAA tournament, they're fundamentally sound and therefore they shouldn't be rattled whatsoever.
Chapman will inbound the ball. Bill Martin, number 24, 6'7" junior forward, has come in for Georgetown.
Georgetown's bench is so long with quality players. There's Gene Smith in the game, and Gene Smith is all over the court.
When he comes in, the intensity defensively steps up about 2 clicks. The captain of this ball club.
And I often get a kick out of John Thompson with his starting lineup. His starting lineup is really not important. It's his finishing lineup that counts. And actually, that is his starting lineup. Coming out right now is probably the best team he can put on the floor.
He plays in guys. He has that kind of depth. Chapman, he's down and good.
Took it right to Patrick Ewing. Used his body to shield the ball. He surprised Patrick.